Verily, there is no end to his glory. Nanak says, whatever is said will remain incomplete, and whatever one sees expresses only his inability. You cannot purify that which is. That is why Lao Tse has coined the word Tao. That which is cannot express that which is. No word can express the glory of that which is of God. I have heard Rabindranath Tagore was on the deathbed. Someone said, now you can live happily. You have done all that was humanly possible. You have attained fame. You composed so many songs. All these songs sing the glory of God. Like a great poet, millions adored you. You kindled the spark of devotion in many. You can now be fulfilled. Nothing remains incomplete. Rabindranath, who was on his deathbed, hearing this, opened his eyes. Then he said, do not say such things. I was praying. I could not sing all that I really wanted to sing. All that I wanted to compose could not be done. So far, I have succeeded in setting the orchestra right. The song as the song of his glory has not yet begun, and the time for departure has come. All the time, I was trying to set the orchestra in order. Whenever any musical concert begins, we try to all the musicians tune themselves together, and then orchestra begins. What is the orchestra that Rabindranath is talking about? Your body, the five sense organs, the mind, the memory, the intellect, the ego sense, the consciousness, these are all the various orchestras that work within you, and they do not work in harmony with one another. In order for a work, in order for a world to come out, which can kindle the spark in a barren heart, a word that can fertilize the barren soil, that can come out only when all these individual instruments are in harmony with one another. I speak to you of my own experience. I may be amidst the crowd, in the world, in the marketplace, and I can compose, write something without even editing. The only editing remains a few minor typographical errors. But when these words reach the people, it certainly creates a spark. Inner orchestra is most important, and that is the emphasis of all the masters in bringing the inner instruments in order and in tune with one another. Rabindranath composed 6,000 songs, and all songs are praises of God. And yet still Rabindranath says he was able to set the orchestra in order. The songs of praise have not yet begun, and the time has come for departure. When one is in love, total love, Whatsoever one feels, he feels always that he has not yet said all that he wanted to say. Such is the experience of all those who have known. This is what Nanak is pointing through these sutras. Whatever is said or can be said is like setting the orchestra in order. Songs of his glory cannot be sung. Who will sing that song? How can magnanimous be encompassed in final? How can magnanimous be encompassed in finite humanness? How can the whole sky come into your fist? All human efforts fail in an effort to sing his glory. This shows human inability. The day this happens, the day you find you are unable to explain the glory of that which is, the day this happens a new understanding dawns. The very thought that you are infinitesimal, you will come to realize the ultimate glory. You will experience it. Ignorant ones consider themselves great, and for men of understanding, they consider themselves ignorant. Ignorant ones consider themselves great, and for the men of understanding, they consider man ignorant. As subtle understanding grows, the ultimate becomes manifest, and then suddenly a moment comes when you are no more, you have dissolved, you have attained to fana. Only he is. There is no one to see. Only he remains. His glory and his ahirnishna, a sound that is constantly happening, uninterrupted. The uncreated existential sound alone remains. There is no doer and no seer. Only doing and seeing remains. The duality of subject and object dissolves in one another. And when you are no more, then who will say anything about that which is? This is the reason that all the mystics have spoken in the moments of. This is the reason. All that mystics have spoken in the moments of awareness, poets have composed, and singers have sung, only to express their inability. Buddha spoke continuously for 40 years. One day he spoke to Mahakashyapa. All that could be spoken, I have spoken for 40 years. Still nothing could be spoken, and all that can be spoken, all that cannot be spoken, I have now given it to Mahakashyapa. That's where the Diamond Sutra or Prajnaparamita Hridayam Sutra came. Mahakashyapa, one day Buddha came on Avantipindika Park in the company of 12,500 monks. He had a flower in his hand. He remained standing. He did not utter a single word. Simply he showed the flower. It had never happened. Buddha remained silent, holding a flower in his hand. Many thoughts came to the mind of the monks. They want to know what is the intention of Buddha today. Mahakashyap, when Buddha looked at Mahakashyap, Mahakashyap simply smiled. And in that very moment, all that could not be said was transferred onto Mahakashyap. Buddha said, I have spoken for 40 years, yet still nothing could be spoken. And whatever could not be spoken, I have handed over to Mahakashyap. And this was the beginning of Zen Buddhism. That aspect of Buddha that we will have later on. When a master, through his tavarju, transfers his energy field, in fact, he is giving you that principle, knowing which everything becomes new. And you realize the moment you read something, you get to its very core. You are not using your mind, although the mind is used as a final instrument to construct the words, to compose the sentences. But it is the consciousness that is working behind everything. This reflects man's helplessness. It is like you have seen something beyond human imagination and you are stuck dumb. Like a deja vu, something has happened to you. You are so nearing God. So to nearing God, one becomes wordless or speechless. A state of deja vu. So all of a sudden something happens that you are not expecting. You become wordless or speechless. Words disappear. Voice chokes. Breathing stops. In such moments, you are in a state of total cessation. No thought flows on the inner sky. Words become motionless. Remember, words become motionless. Breathing ceases. Heartbeat suddenly stops. It is in such moments of awareness or surati. Nanak overflows these words as ultimate message of understanding. There is no end to his glories and there is no way to glorify God. There is no end to his glory and there is no end to his message. There is no end to his deeds. No end to his infinite bounties, no end to his manifestations, no end to his inner secrets, no end to the extension of his creation. No one can really come to know the beginning and end of the creation. To know this, many strive in vain. When this creation has begun, from where and where this creation will, and when will this creation come to an end or cease, no one knows. From these messages, take three things in account. First, as long as you feel that you have known God, you have deluded. You are mistaken. Remember that which you have known cannot be God. The more you know, the more he remains unknown and unknowable. That is why Hindus say God, or that which is unknown and unknowable. That which you have encompassed within finiteness cannot be God. that whose depth you have known cannot be ocean. Maybe you are taking a dive in a shallow pond, but you have not reached near the ocean. Maybe in an effort to climb the highest mountain peak, you have climbed somewhere else. This is impossible. It is impossible in the sense that you are part of that. How can part know the whole? This is your hand. How will your hand know you? You can hold anything in this world, but how can you hold yourself? The eye can see everything that which is around, but your eyes cannot see you, because eyes are part of you. You cannot see your being with your eyes. Part can never know the whole. You will certainly get the glimpses, but not the total vision. You are part of the whole. If you were really separate from God, you could have known. You know something because that which you want to know is not part of you. A piece of paper lying in front of you, a wall in front of you, a computer, or any other device, you can know all about it because it is not part of you. That which is part of you, you cannot know. If you were really separate from God, you could have known. But you are part of that which is. You are His heartbeat. You are His pulse. You are His incoming and outgoing breath. How can you circle around Him? Man is a speck of dust of that wholeness. Like a drop, you are part of the ocean. In a way, the drop knows the ocean. In its deepest sense, drop knows the ocean. Ocean is not separate from the drop. Still, in reality, drop can never know the ocean. Why? Because drop and ocean are inseparable. This is the paradox of religiousness. In a sense, you know God. Without knowing, you cease to exist. He pulsates in you. So too you do pulsate in Him. In a sense, you know Him, yet still you do not. You are part of Him. Can a part know the whole? You can dwell and float in that. You are like fish that lives, floats, and breathes in ocean. Ocean is all around the fish, ever, below and all around. However, the fish does not know the ocean. Being part of that, you really remain oblivious of that. And sometimes, in such moments of fading glimpses, a feeling comes that you have known. Heart overflows an immeasurable joy. You have recognized. A vision happens and then suddenly fades away, and suddenly darkness surrounds. You start once again meeting. This gap between knowing and then not knowing is the state of a real religious person. The gap between knowing and then not knowing is the state of the real religious person. Whenever one will ask Buddha about God, silence was his response. What can a Buddha see? If he says that he knows, it is a mistake. And if he denies that too is a mistake, then silence is the only answer. I cannot say anything about God, and I cannot deny. One morning a priest inquired from Buddha about God. Buddha remained silent. The priest went away. Ananda asked Buddha why he remained silent. The man was really a great priest. He was really worthy, and still he remained silent. Buddha responded, "The man was worthy. This made me silent. If all that I speak turns out to be wrong, and unless one really knows, one needs to remain silent. Who is there to say that I know? These are the functions of ego that I know. An ego can never know. It can only claim to have known. Then accepting or denying both are the functions of ego. The man had understood my silence. This is the reason he bowed down before me. There is no need to see anything. You would have seen what happens between lover and beloved. They speak, love speaks through silent gestures. Silent gestures. No word goes on. There remains intense silence between the lover and the beloved. They look at one another and feel fulfilled. Just a mere touch makes them feel fulfilled. And what happens between husband and wife, if they do not talk, it appears as if something is gone wrong. And if in love, between lovers and beloved, if a word happens, means something is gone wrong. Then Ananda realized that before leaving, the man bowed out of gratitude. Ananda said, strangely enough, he could not understand what really the man understood. With this comes the methodology of the master. Buddha said there are three types of horses. First of those who move inch by inch. Once they are whipped, first are those who move inch by inch, once they are whipped. Second are those who need no whip, just threaten them and that is enough for them to move. And lastly are those horses who need not be whipped or threatened. Just the shadow of the whip is enough and horse runs on its journey. The world is like a whip and silence is like the shadow. Word is needed, that horse is not close by. Who can begin the journey? Just seeing the shadow of the whip, Buddha said, man understood. Such is the state of those who know. He cannot say that he knows. Also, he cannot say that he does not know. Word is like the whip, and the silence is like the shadow. Nanak says, there is no end. The more you say, the more he remains unsaid. All scriptures remain incomplete. No scripture on earth can really be complete. That will mean God can be said or put within the finiteness of the world. All scriptures are for those who cannot understand the shadow of the witnesses. When you come in the company of the master, you begin to get the experience to know what the shadow is, what the silence is, how it is the silence that communicates. It is the silence that communes. It is the silence that communes. All religiousness depends. As religiousness deepens, you can see his hands all around, his impressions, his creation, the creativity surrounding you. Also, you can see his bounty surrounding you, his creation, and the manifestations are spread all around. Yet still millions go on seeking God and inquiring about God. They go on inquiring about the Creator, but they cannot get the glimpse of the invisible hands of the Creator in the creation. Creator is hidden in his creation. In fact, Creator is the process of creation. Creator is the process of creation. They cannot get a glimpse of the invisible hand of the Creator in the creation. Behind this vast creation, they cannot see the invisible hands. Strangely enough, these are the same people who accept everything blindly in the name of faith. No scientist has seen electron, the last particle of electricity, which is the basis of this existence. Electron is the minutest particle and it is the basis of this existence. The entire world that you see around you, the matter, is made out of this electrical particle called electron. Also, there is no hope for any scientist to ever see the electron. Yet still the scientist believes in electron because the results are all around. The reason is subtle. The result is gross. The hands of God are invisible, but creation is visible. Man accepts the presence of electron because of the result all around. But the same man denies God, though the result is all around. A flower blossoms. The invisible hand that makes the flowers blossom cannot be seen. The seed decomposes into its flower. The seed decomposes to sprout. The invisible energy and the hands are not seen. How from the stone-like heart seed, so many delicate flowers can blossom? How can from a stony heart so much message can overflow? All around are his invisible signatures, but hands are not visible. How can hands remain visible? Because life is a balance between gross and subtle. The cause always remains subtle, but the result is always gross. God is the ultimate cause of existence, but the result surrounds us. The result is gross. I have said there are three types of people in the world. Buddha called these three types of forces. First, of those who are totally blind. These cannot see the creation and go on inquiring about God. For them, creation is not the proof. These people still need some kind of proof. What else can be a greater proof? Life is moving chronologically in a balanced way. In this entire creation, there is a synergistic harmony. An uncreated spontaneous music echoes. There is no chaos. That is why it is cosmos. This is not happening by chance. Instead, there is a subtle law operating behind everything. This subtle law we call as a dhamma. Buddha used the word dhamma. Lao Tzu used the word Tao. Nanak used the word hukum. That is the religion. Not Hinduism, Christianity, or Islam, or Judaism is the religion. The subtle law, that is the cause of this happening, that is creating this synergistic harmony around us, is dhamma, is Tao, is hukum. When Nanak says everything is happening by his order, never consider that like a traffic police is directing everything to be in order. Hukum means a subtle order. Krishna says in the beginning, in Bhagavad Gita, in the beginning of the creation I has created a law. The world known as the law of action. And it is this law that continues to operate and allows the things to happen. It is subtle. Its effects are deeper than we can understand. I have given you an example. Person walking with itching gets burned. The hand gets a wound, a certain part of the skin is burned. Goes to the doctor, a treatment begins. The healing of the wound takes a little while. But anyways, the wound is healed. This is the one aspect of law action, the physical. The other aspect of that is it leaves a scar on the skin, and that scar is subtler than the wound that was inflicted on the hand. And this will take another type of treatment. You cannot treat the scar that has been left by the wound on your hand in the same way as you have used the treatment for the wound. A different kind of treatment is necessary. Maybe skin grafting, maybe something else. And then, during the period that the wound was inflicted, and when a scar remains on your skin, it leaves a scar on your psyche. That is even deeper than that, and nobody knows, only you feel it. And that is even deeper, and a different kind of methodology is required to heal that. These are basically, in a gross form, three effects of an action. And unless the effects of these actions can be removed at all these three levels, you cannot understand the function. This is what is meant by hukum, a subtle order. This is what is meant by Tao. This is a system, a subtle system. This is cosmos, not chaos. Everything is happening for a specific reason. Nothing happens without a reason. If someone slaps you, there is a reason. If someone gives you a hug, this is a reason. You know not. Because when we are interacting in the world of objects and beings, we are unconscious. We never complete a particular action. A thought comes to your mind. It needs to be put in action. Anything incomplete will remain as a scar into your consciousness. You have started a work, the weekend approaches, You leave the file because you have to go somewhere. Now the work you have understood could have finished in next 20 minutes to 30 minutes. If you leave it incomplete, you will not be able to complete it on Monday morning. You will have to refresh your memory with that work that you have been doing. You have to go through the files. And then there are many stories in the scriptures that explain this very aspect. It is said in one of the incarnations when Vishnu the sustainer, in order to remove the atrocities of the demons, incarnated as Vijit, a boy 10 to 12 years of age, well built, beautiful, appears in front of the demon king body. He had his daughter named Ratnamala, beautiful name. Mala means garland, Ratna means jewels, a garland of jewels. She was beautiful, the daughter of the king. As soon as she saw this young boy, little boy, she felt a very strong tendency in her. I wish I could breastfeed this boy. I wish I could breastfeed this boy. Sometimes, does any of these thoughts not come to your mind when you see someone? And because of many reasons, you do not nourish and do not effectuate this thought that has come to your mind. It remains. The story goes on. She could not do anything. Just a thought remained in her mind. I wish I could breastfeed this boy. Then it happened this, as a young little boy, he asked for, a Brahmin boy, he asked for 3 feet space of land for his survival. The demon guru recognized who he was. He tried to dissuade the king from fulfilling this promise. But king was known for his generosity. Once he has given a word, he will fulfill it. So this boy said, I cannot really rely on your words unless you make a scriptural promise. A scriptural promise, according to Hindus, it is called a sankalpa, a kind of a determination before you begin a prayer. It is done in a particular way. You are taking the water in your hand, holding the water, just as when we go to the court, you are given the scripture of your choice. Holding the scripture in the hand, you say that, whatsoever I will say is true to my knowledge, and whatsoever it is, court asks you to do. This is the normal tradition. So he was to take the water in his hand and repeat the words that I have agreed to give you 3 steps worth of land. And he had a spouted pot, and Shukracharya, the demon guru master, entered into the nozzle so that the water could not come, and if the water does not come, the promise could not be fulfilled. So it happened in the story, continues, the promise was fulfilled. And as soon as the promise was fulfilled, this little Brahmin boy assumed his magnanimous form, that he is the sustainer of the machine. In one step he measured the earth, in the next he measured the entire sky in the middle regions, and when it was the time for the third step, he asked, "Where should I put the third step?" The king bowed down to him and he said, "You can put the third step on my feet. With that, my atrocities will vanish and I will be slain in the hands of the sustainer." Seeing this, the daughter of the demon king Ratnamala was filled with anger, animosity, and she was filled with the thought that I wish I could kill this woman. The person is the same. Two different types of thought comes. The first set of thought, I wish I could breastfeed this child. An expression of extreme love. When the circumstance or situation is changed, for the same person you have a different kind of thought, that I wish I could kill him. Something like this happens between the spouse, husbands and wives. Because there is no experience of inner harmony within, all the musical instruments within are playing their own tune. It is, the orchestra is out of tune. Every human being is out of tune. Unless one attains to inner tuning, things like this happen. This is a day-to-day life. One without two. Sun never rose, never set in your life. Today life has changed. That person creates no more ripples in your life. His name does not create anything in your life. Not even a single sensation in your life. Does it not happen? This is the nature of our life. Ratnamala has two thoughts for the same person within a short span of time. How this could dissolve? It cannot remain incomplete. The Lord accepts it. Time flowed on. The story of the 10 incarnations finished. The time finished. Then it was only when Vishnu incarnated as Krishna, his uncle, who was a demon king, knew that the 8th child of Devi and Vasudev, that was the name, the real parents of Krishna, will be his destroyer. In every possible manner, he tried to kill the child. He sent many demons. Then he sends a demoness named Putna. She goes. The Krishna was born and he was transported into another area so that he can remain protected. This demoness Putna knew the whereabouts of Krishna. She comes smearing poison on her breast with an intention to breastfeed. Two things simultaneously happened. She first thought was that I wish I could breastfeed the child. And second thought, I wish I could kill him. I wish I could kill him. So she comes smeared the poison smeared on her breast. So she will breastfeed the child. And with the poison, the child will be killed. How many of us really know or aware when something is happening around you, when someone insults you, your ego comes to play its role. How many of us are aware that it is out of my past doing that I have to undergo this state of pain and pleasure, this state of suffering? I have narrated you the story of Buddha. Buddha went to a village where he was not supposed to go. Every morning he will dress up and he will go in a particular direction. People will gather. A commune happened. Buddha will begin his sermon. So this morning when he reached there, a man from amidst the crowd came. Buddha was summoned. He abused Buddha. Buddha did not respond. If someone abuses you, what would you do? Imagine. What is the difference between you and Buddha? Buddha saw the deeper reason. You cannot see. But if understanding the message of Buddha, you remain quiet, maybe it is one of my past doings that this has happened. And deep within, you aspire. May this reason be revealed to me for the cause of my suffering. Why am I undergoing this suffering? My intelligence is unable to understand this. Please reveal the reason to me. A different kind of silence descends on you. Buddha remained quiet. Ananda responded. Ananda reacted to this. And he said, Buddha, this man, you are such an innocent man. This man has insulted you and you have not uttered a single word. Buddha said, Ananda, this man has not said anything to you. Why are you opening an account with him? By reacting to a person who has not done anything to you, this kind of people I call Mr. Unnecessary. They always come in between to give their opinion. No one has asked me, why should I give my opinion? If you ask me, I will speak. Buddha said, Anand, do you know what is the reason why I have come to this village? I have come only because of this man. Knowingly, I have closed all my accounts. Only one account was opened with this man. And unless I close this account, I cannot be freed from this cycle of birth and death. I cannot be freed from this cycle of birth and death. Whatsoever is happening in your life, pain, at the physical level, at the psychological level, at any other level, is the outcome of those unfinished, unfulfilled actions that were performed in a state of unconsciousness. You have to relive those moments. The moment you have decided to live those moments consciously, with gratitude, that I am exhausting all those existing actions and not creating anymore. Because life has been given to you for three reasons. Firstly, to exhaust all that accumulated actions that you have done in the past, knowingly or unknowingly. Secondly, you continue to live your life of awareness that you are not going to create any more actions. Then at the end of the journey, your slate will remain clean. We unnecessarily interfere in the matter of others. Unless someone asks me something, why should I speak? I have narrated you two incidents in the past, if you recall. In a train, a man was sitting, surrounded by his suitcases and luggage on his seat. The man had glasses and was reading the newspaper. The other passengers asked him, "Sir, can you remove these suitcases so that we can also sit down as passengers?" The man did not respond. Continued reading the newspaper, unaware of the presence of all these passengers. Then they shook him. When they shook him, first, now you see how irritating would it be to you if you were the part of that. He put down his newspaper, then he took off his glasses, folded it, put it in the glass case, put it in the pocket. Then he looked towards the person, "Did you ask me anything? How would you feel that time?" And when they said to the people asked him to remove the luggage, he said, "I am not willing to remove the luggage and I will not." He took out his glass case, opened it, took his glasses, closed the glass case, put it in the pocket, put on the glasses, pick up the newspaper and started reading. And ultimately it was discovered that this luggage did not belong to him. It belonged to an army man who was sleeping on the berth upstairs, on the second, in the train, the higher berth. So when the people inquired, he was still unaware, unaffected by all that was happening. Then everybody asked, "Why you did not tell me that this luggage did not belong to you?" He said, "Nobody asked me that question. Everybody was asking me to remove the luggage. If I had done, the same thing would have happened to me. The person, the army man, would have slapped me. If you had asked me the right question, I would have answered, given you the right answer. You asked me to remove the luggage. How can I remove the luggage which does not belong to me? But you did not ask me, does this luggage belong to you or not? In response to that question, I can say, no, it does not belong to me. Then I am finished with you. You are finished with me. You will find out whose luggage is there. But we go on interfering in the matters of the others, not realizing the effect of this impermanence to us. And then Buddha said, "Ananda, you will not know when you have to pay for this action. This man has not done anything to you, but you are unnecessarily creating an action. This life is given to you to close all the existing accounts and continue to live your life with a clean slate, living moment to moment, full of awareness that you do not create any more actions. You do not create any more impressions in your consciousness. The inner sky remains crystal clear. Nothing is clear." This subtle law was called by Buddha as Dhamma, as Hukum by Nanak and Tao by Lao Tzu. Every seed has to become a flower. Hukum means a subtle order. This is a system, a subtle system. This is cosmos, not chaos. Everything is happening for a specific reason. The moment you understand, that great peace will descend into you. Everything is happening for a specific reason. Everything is moving towards a predestined goal or end. And what is this predestined end? Every seed has to become a flower, and then one day again a seed. This process will continue. Har band kali ko khilna hai aur khilkar murjhana hai. Every closed bud has to blossom one day and then wither away. Har band kali ko khilna hai aur khilkar murjhana hai. Sai ki sada sun ja baba. Therefore listen to the wise. Every closed bud has to blossom one day and then wither away. Therefore listen to the song eternal of the man of awakening. He constantly sings this song. Everything is happening for a specific reason. Everything is moving towards a predestined goal or end. And what is this predestined end? Every seed has to become a flower and then wither away to become a seed once again. This is a continuous process. It shall continue ever until each seed becomes a flower, blossoms, becomes a flower, and then withers away to become a seed once again. The process.